Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to CSIS. My name is Andy Cutchins. I'm director of the Russia and Eurasia program here. And it's really a special, special privilege and honor to welcome you here and to serve as the host for this really unique event. And I want to first thank the Embassy of Kazakhstan and the NSA, the NSA being the National Security Archive. I couldn't resist that one, Tom. It was teed up. It was so easy. But I'm sure you've heard that many times before. To talk about Project Sapphire and its significance. For those of you that don't know, this was a 1994 covert operation of the U.S. government in cooperation with Kazakhstan to reduce the threat of nuclear proliferation as part of the Cooperation Threat Reduction Program, or more familiarly known as the Nunn-Lugar program. A warehouse at the Olba Metallurgical Plant outside Ust-Kamenogorsk housed 1,322 pounds, about 600 kilos, of weapons-grade enriched uranium to fuel Alpha-class submarines. Following the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the fuel was not so well documented and secured, and the danger of being sold for use in the construction of nuclear weapons. And this is the 20th anniversary of that successful operation, which was part of the most successful U.S. assistance program since the Marshall Program, that being the Cooperative Threat Reduction Program, the Nunn-Lugar Program. And in fact, this month, November 2014, marks the 23rd anniversary of the passing of that landmark piece of legislation. It's kind of an interesting story. We had hoped to show a video of then Secretary of Defense Bill Perry commenting and talking about Project Sapphire and its significance. And unfortunately, for technological reasons, we're not able to show the video this evening. But it took me to reviewing the really important book that he and Ash Carter wrote, published in 1999, Preventive Defense, and where Secretary Perry actually was at Stanford at that time when I was there at the Center for International Security and Cooperation. And the key phrase that he uses to describe CTR, the Nunn-Lugar program, is defense by other means. And I think that's a really very, very significant and deep concept for us to think about, and it's what this story will bring us here to today. But it was also interesting to read the section, there's a chapter two of the book is about Project Sapphire and the CTR program. And it was on November 19th that Bill Perry and Ash Carter came to Washington and they briefed Senator Nunn, who's here with us this evening as well, and Senator Lugar about the program and their aides. The piece of legislation apparently was written on November 22nd, within 2 days of the briefing, and the legislation was passed on November 28th, 9 days later. That's when Washington worked. And here are today two statesmen who made Washington work, bipartisanship on important security issues. So it's really a thrill for me to welcome you all here. And now I'd like to turn the floor over to the distinguished ambassador from Kazakhstan, Khairat Umarov, Your Excellency.
Thank you, Andy, for this warm introduction and for hosting all of us today. It's a pleasure to welcome you all here on this important occasion to commemorate the Project Sapphire's 20th anniversary. It's indeed a special day for all of us and for especially Kazakhstan, for U.S. Kazakhstan cooperation, but I think also for the global security. I just want to start by acknowledging the presence of some of our outstanding friends. I haven't seen Bill Courtney, but he should be somewhere here. who was the first U.S. ambassador to Kazakhstan. We have Jackson McDonald here, who worked at that time with Bill Courtney at the embassy in Almaty. Dr. Jeffrey Starr, who actually was the leader of the secret Tiger Team. All of them played an instrumental roles in the U.S.-Kazakhstan landmark project against nuclear proliferation. Thank you all for joining us today. Tell you frankly, in preparation of this event, we thought of inviting Secretary Perry to come and be here with us tonight. Mr. Cudgins has already mentioned that there is a good video which was so nicely speaking about this Project Sapphire, about the successful completion of it. We wanted to show it tonight, but unfortunately it was a technical problem. We couldn't get Secretary Perry as well because of his health reasons, but actually probably tonight we can hear some more names who were very much involved with this secretive operation. I was told that Ash Carter and Dan Poneman are away from the town, and I wish, of course, they could also join us today. I'm also very delighted to welcome my great friend Andy Weber, who since his diplomatic assignment in Kazakhstan in 1993 has held several important positions, including recently Assistant Secretary of Defense for Nuclear, Chemical, and Biological Defense Programs. His current job is indeed no less challenging and yet no less noble. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Project Sapphire and Kazakhstan actually played a great role in your life and career. A couple of years ago, during one of my first visits in my previous capacity as Deputy Foreign Minister at our meeting here in Washington, Andy gave me a book, fresh from the press, which the same year was awarded the Pulitzer Prize. An extraordinary story, beautifully researched, elegantly told, whose author I'm delighted to welcome here tonight. Thank you, David Hoffman, for being part of this evening, and the book was called Dead Hand. I hope that your book will become a scenario for Hollywood blockbuster sometime in the future. I want to especially thank Laura Holgate for joining us tonight. Laura was one of the was on the original team with Ash Carter, who conceived the Cooperative Threat Reduction Program. She's been working on it ever since, and today leads those efforts at the White House. Laura has just recently hosted a very productive nuclear security summit, Sherpa meeting, and I want to stress that Kazakhstan is committed to be a good contributor to making 2016 Chicago summit as a success. My special thanks also go to the NSA, National Security Archive, its director, Tom Blanton, and our good friend, Dr. Svetlana Savranskaya. Thank you for helping organizing this event. Next spring, Kazakhstan's Ministries of Foreign Affairs and Energy, in cooperation with the National Security Archive, plan to host a four-day critical oral history conference to commemorate the 20th anniversary since the last piece of Soviet nuclear weapons left the territory of Kazakhstan. We look forward to working with you on this event as well. Dear ladies and gentlemen, you probably ask yourself why Kazakhstan Embassy is organizing this event tonight. And my answer is that people in Kazakhstan deeply care about national security and nuclear non-proliferation. We did a lot in this sphere. We closed the nuclear testing site. We joined the NPT as a non-nuclear state. We get rid of our fourth largest nuclear arsenal voluntarily, shortly after achieving independence. We are the ones who are creating a Central Asia nuclear weapons-free zone in our part of the world. We're part of many other important developments in that particular sphere. And I think Kazakhstan has convincingly demonstrated to the international community that a peaceful foreign policy, openness and cooperation, and not possession of WMD or the threat of its use are essential to security and prosperity. I myself, I was very much involved in the first anti-nuclear movement, which was called Nevada SMA, before joining the Foreign Service. And I was very much involved in closing the nuclear testing site. So Kazakhstan stands very firmly against nuclear testing. And I know firsthand experience of talking to people and seeing people suffering from this devastating and very hazardous impact of nuclear testing. So we think that that fight should continue being fought. This critical judgment paved the way for 22 years of, our cooperation, 22 years of close and strategic cooperation between Kazakhstan and the United States based on trust and shared values. The solid base of cooperation between our countries has led to a long list of successes, from Project Sapphire to Project Groundhog to cleaning the Dagalin Mountain. Kazakhstan and the United States are leading the way in innovative cooperation on nuclear security. Dear friends, we believe that Nunn-Lugar program, the cornerstone of U.S.-Kazakhstan cooperation, provides a good platform for global cooperation to reduce weapons and nuclear materials. So today it's both a privilege and pleasure to introduce, I thought, one of the authors, but today we have both of the authors of the Cooperative Threat Reduction Program, the Honorable Senator Dick Lugar and Senator Sam Nunn. An internationally respected statesman, Senator Lugar and Senator Nunn served with great distinction in the United States Congress for many years. Notably, Senator Lugar was the chairman of the influential Senate Committee for Foreign Relations, and Kazakhstan is grateful for your support in non-proliferation and disarmament issue. Thank you, Senator, for your foresight and for your leadership in advancing the vision for a safer world. Both senators are active today. After retirement, Senator Nunn today is leading quite an active international efforts, NGO called Nuclear Threat Reduction Initiative, with which we have several good events, and they were part of the Nuclear Security Summit as well. Senator Lugar, after retirement, created a Richard Lugar Institute, which is sustaining his great passions for creating a world with fewer nuclear dangers, while at the same time promoting food security for the world's poor and needy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with your applause the Honorable Richard Lugar, former chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and a great friend of Kazakhstan.
Mr. Ambassador, this is a very exciting evening for all of us, but I just simply want to say that it's especially exciting to be with my partner, Sam Nunn, and to have an opportunity really to reminisce just a bit before we get to the serious parts of our program this evening. At the time that the Nunn-Lugar Act came into being, the Soviet Union was breaking up, and only a few months later, Kazakhstan gained its independence. A few months after that, Sam Nunn and I decided to visit Almaty and were received ultimately by President Nazarbayev, the first opportunity we had had to meet the president. There were many things to talk about, including the residence for our ambassador who would come to represent our country there. But in a more serious vein, we talked about nuclear weapons. And I must say that, and Sam is here to audit this evening my recollections, that President Nazarbayev, on the one hand, I think saw the desirability of beginning to wind down some of the problems there, the difficulties in terms of relations with Russia, just the technical aspects of maintenance and all of the infrastructure involved were going to be very, very troublesome. At the same time, my recollection is he wanted to know, what is Ukraine going to do? Which was an interesting question. It's often stated, and perhaps correctly, that your country had the fourth largest number and or weight or what have you of nuclear weapons. Ukraine was either fourth or fifth in the batting order. And so let me just say that it makes life very simple. Sam and I tried to solve that for him. We went to see the president of Ukraine, President Kravchuk, just after the election in our country in 1992, and proposed that we knew he wanted to get rid of his nuclear weapons, had difficulties in the Rada of people who wanted to hang on to indicate the importance of Ukraine in the world. And so we made a proposal of money the United States might be able to provide through the Nunn-Lugar program or wherever else we might be able to get it. He was very excited about that. And this led then to a decision on his part. And that may have led to some decision-making in Astana, likewise. But in any event, Sam and I had the privilege of returning to see the president of your country several occasions in the glorious new capital as it was built, one time in the summertime, another time when it was 20 degrees below zero. Unbelievable, but nevertheless, all a part of our Nunn-Lugar diplomacy and all a part of the cooperation of your country in moving forward. And so I was so pleased when I heard this 20th anniversary of Project Sapphire was going to be celebrated tonight. I went, of course, to David Hoffman's chapter 21 to check out, to make certain we remembered all the details. I had seen Andy Weber not too long ago. He once again has moved from the Defense Department to the State Department, doing the Lord's work, fighting Ebola or whatever else it is they're fighting over there. And Andy is simply indefatigable as his career progresses. We're so grateful. And Laura Hogate, really a veteran of the trail, in so many of our trips traveling with us, when she was not there, she was communicating, so we were on the right track, asked the right questions. I say to everyone involved in this ceremony tonight, this 20th anniversary, more power to you. It's a great evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm Tom Blanton. I'm the director of the National Security Archive, the other NSA, the tiny NSA. But it's such an honor and a privilege for me to be here. I was supposed to take a few minutes to do introductions, but in fact, between Ambassador Umarov's wonderful diplomatic introduction of all three of our panelists and Senator Lugar's appreciation of all three of our panelists, I really won't take much time. I would love to. We're going to hear from David Hoffman, the Pulitzer Prize-winning author of The Dead Hand, to give us the context of the time, the end of the Cold War, the collapsing Soviet Union, the threat of nuclear weapons, and then the legacy of that arms race. Then we're going to turn to Andy Weber, who was on the ground as a young diplomat in Kazakhstan, who actually discovers this uranium, half a ton or so. And to give us the view from the ground, he called himself a field hand for Jeff Starr, the head of cooperative threat reduction at that moment. But I think Andy has an extraordinary story. And then we'll turn to Laura Holgate, who at that moment was in the Pentagon working with Ash Carter, but has also the long view of the 20-some-odd years of extraordinary progress. And I just want to point you to the National Security Archive website, because this video that you've heard about where Secretary Perry announces the discovery and the securing of the uranium is embedded. You just have to scroll down one screen from when you log on at nsarchive.org. You'll see the video. You can click and hear Secretary Perry. It was in a press conference with the Secretary of Energy and the Secretary of State announcing this extraordinary success and giving the credit to the Nunn-Lugar program. You'll also, if you go on down, you will see what the documents fetishists at the National Security Archive really do, because we posted also a series of the declassified documents related to Project Sapphire, including Ambassador Courtney's wonderful cable about the meeting between Senator Lugar, Senator Nunn, and President Nazarbayev in November 1992, where they had this discussion. You can now go back, read it for yourself, and see the level of discussion and commitment by the Republic of Kazakhstan to the cause of nuclear nonproliferation. So check out the website. You'll also see wonderful pictures of a very young, he doesn't seem to age very much, Andy Weber in his lab coat. You'll see pictures of the C-5As landing at the airport. They had to use a jet engine, I'm told, to clear the snow and ice off the runways in one case. But we'll get to some of those stories. But let me just turn it to David Hoffman, who's been our guru and guide on this extraordinary research project as we attempt to really excavate and bring to public notice one of the greatest underappreciated success stories of American foreign policy in our lifetime. And it's still going on. David.
Great, thanks, Tom. You know, I'd like to say that as we sit here tonight and think about this as a great success story, it's very easy to forget that Nunn-Lugar almost didn't happen. And I want to take you back to that time 23 years ago, to those autumn months when the Soviet Union was coming apart. And remind everybody that at that time there were many people in Washington who thought that it was just fine if the Soviet Union came apart and was not an alarming development. There was a mindset that our adversary was collapsing and that would be good for us. There was an Assistant Secretary of Defense at the time who said, we've spent 50 years trying to bankrupt these people and now it's happened. Let them go into free fall. And there was a former national security advisor to a president who said, I thought there was a positive benefit in the breakup of command and control over strategic nuclear weapons in the Soviet Union to several other republics. Well, this attitude, we won, don't do anything, didn't make sense to a small number of people. And two of them are here with us tonight, Senators Lugar and Senator Nunn. And I would like to remind you that neither of them were new to this topic. Their work in arms control for many years, their concern about nuclear dangers had made contacts with Soviet officials. They had been there, they had visited. They understood the dangers. And when Senator Nunn was in Moscow right after the failed August coup attempt and looked Gorbachev in the eye and said, did you lose control of the nuclear suitcase? There was silence. And when Senator Nunn came home, thinking about what he had seen on the streets of Moscow, chaos, paralysis, he thought, I need to do something about this. And that was a moment when a lot of Washington didn't want to do something about this. Senator Nunn went to the late Les Aspin and said, we need to do something about this. Les was chairman of House Armed Services. They came up with a bill. It had some of what Aspin wanted, humanitarian aid. It had some of what Senator Nunn wanted, aid to help secure nuclear materials. They took it to the floor. The bill flopped. Senator Nunn refused to say no, picked himself up, tried again, brought experts to Washington. And this is a particularly interesting moment. After the first bill failed, Senator Nunn met in Washington with two Soviet officials from the institute in Moscow, Andrei Kokoshin and Sergei Rogov, and they came and had a breakfast at which Senator Lugar was invited to. And at this breakfast, they said, you know, senators, we want you to know there's a volatile, dangerous situation in Moscow. Senator Lugar later told my colleague Don Oberdorfer that that particular moment was a very alarming conversation. And a few days later, Ash Carter came down and told the senators, never before has a nuclear power disintegrated. And eventually, after listening to this, bringing in other senators, a little bit of a groundswell started to develop. But believe me, this was not something that the president was talking about. The country was looking inward. People were breathing a sigh of relief. And these senators were undeterred. They got the bill passed, and Senator Lugar, in endorsing Senator Nunn's bill, took to the floor and said, nuclear weapons do not simply fade away. They must be disabled, dismantled, and destroyed. I want to just remind you all of this because Nunn-Lugar today seems like a natural, and indeed it was, a visionary response to what had happened in the world. But it wasn't a sure thing. And as we think about what we will do next time, we should remember this was a gamble with history. It helped Russia and the former Soviet republics deal with a horrible inheritance. But it took courage, and it took vision, and it took a fair amount of stubbornness to get it off the ground and to get it started.
Amen. Let me turn to Andy Weber and just give us the view, young diplomat, Kazakhstan, but with some really interesting pieces of information that you then develop. And then what did it look like, and then how did that develop to Project Sapphire?
Well, thank you, Tom. It's humbling to be here this evening with the founders of the Nunn-Lugar program. And I was just a field hand at that time. And I also reread David Hoffman's chapter last night. And the Wall Street Journal article that he quoted that said, U.S. Embassy Almaty made for diplomats who find Paris a bore. And indeed, that was me. And the next day I volunteered to serve there. And what an exciting time. It was a brand new country, and they were trying to figure out, what do we do? A new foreign ministry that Khairat Umarov joined right out of the Nevada Semi anti-nuclear movement. And so many people made such a difference, and many of my colleagues and partners are here this evening. What really was the genius of the Nunn-Lugar program? And in hindsight, as David said, it looks like a no-brainer. Of course we removed to Tennessee and blended down 600 kilograms of highly enriched uranium. That was the obvious thing to do. But Jeff Stark can tell you that there were really bitter feuds at the National Security Council as to whether this was the right thing to do. And after we first reported that we had been approached about the existence of this 600 kilograms of HEU, there was a lot of skepticism. A lot of people thought it was a scam, and indeed at the time there were all kinds of scams circulating. And it wasn't really until that very, very cold, snowy day, Senator Lugar referred to minus 20, but I remember some days that were minus 40, really crisp. when we visited at the invitation of President Nazarbayev, who upon independence made a decision that Kazakhstan was going to be free of weapons of mass destruction. And he didn't just say it, he made it happen, and he found in the United States, thanks to the Nunn-Lugar program, a natural partner for that. But we visited the site with Elwood Gift from the Y-12 in Oak Ridge Laboratory, and we saw and took samples and analyzed on site and took some samples back to the United States. 600 kilograms of highly enriched uranium at this factory in Ust-Kamenogorsk, Kazakhstan, in assorted stainless steel buckets, in pipes, and it was almost banal that there were just these chunks of metal spaced apart so they wouldn't reach a critical mass. But when we returned to Almaty and Bill Courtney, who was also a bold and fearless leader, and Jackson McDonald, we reported back to Washington that indeed there were about 600 kilograms of 90% enriched U-235. Some of it, about 126 kilograms in pure uranium metal form, directly usable. And he said, and this was true, he said it was protected by a good padlock. And I remember it well. It was, you see them in
Home Depot?
In antique stores.
Oh.
with the big key, and indeed, there was a female guard with a 9mm Makarov. Apparently, they were more reliable than the male guards because they didn't drink as much. But that, and Jeff will attest to this, that certainly got Washington's attention. It wasn't just conjecture. It wasn't just the factory director who was sharing this information for whatever reason. It was real, and that mobilized Washington and the technical expertise, and it took time. But by that fall, right before winter really hit hard, and I remember that evening like it was yesterday, driving in the lead car of a secure convoy from the Ust-Kamenogorsk factory out to the airfield where the C-5s, the first C-5 was going to land to load up and transport for that long flight back to the United States, the highly enriched uranium. And we were sliding on black ice. And we had these big trucks loaded up with pallets and barrels of HEU sliding around. And I just couldn't imagine having to report to Washington that one of them had slid off a bridge right into the Irtysh River. But thankfully, in that part of the world, people know how to drive even on black ice. And we made it to the airfield and sent that HEU on its way to Tennessee. But it was an incredible experience. And what I didn't know at the time was that this was a big boost to the Nunn-Lugar program. There were a lot of skeptics. And it really set a good precedent. And Laura will talk more about this. But for the whole concept of removal and elimination, not just in place, but in this case, removing it from the country. And we had some follow-on operations that were based on that similar model, and indeed, right through the nuclear security summits. Just recently, some HEU was removed from Kharkiv, Ukraine. But it was definitely the best years of my life. I loved living in Kazakhstan. It was a beautiful country, as Jackson McDonald remembers. We played hard and we worked hard. Hiking, the mountains were heavenly, like Tian Shan, the heavenly mountains, hunting, and the hunting trip that Vitaly Mete, the factory director, invited me on was an incredible moment in my life, and I suppose 20 years later we can say the rest is history.
It's not quite history yet, right? And I was just thinking as you were remarking on the removal as a strategy that, and we should circle back to this, the little matter of, say, Syrian chemical weapons, because talk about the parallels to today and the challenges of today. But I'll ask you about that. But let's turn to Laura and just maybe segue us from the time of Sapphire to today's challenges. Laura Holgate.
Well, I have to say, the Project Sapphire was one of the most exciting and meaningful projects I'd ever been associated with, even though I wasn't on the ground, you know, watching the sparks fly as the testing went on although I heard about it. But having been in on the ground floor of the Nunn-Lugar program, I can tell you that even, you know, in 94, you know, the Nunn-Lugar program was still fresh. When we were sitting up at Harvard kind of envisioning what the context of a Nunn-Lugar program might be, certainly removing 25 bombs worth of HEU from Kazakhstan was not really what we had thought of. But, you know, thanks to the vision of two gentlemen who have given me a life's work, if I can put it that way, that to create a flexibility and a capacity and the tools to do this kind of job when the time came and when it became very clear that that was the answer, that was really exciting. And I remember sitting in the very back as a very baby special assistant to Assistant Secretary Carter at the time. And I remember the press conference at the Pentagon with Secretary of Defense Bill Perry and Secretary of Energy Hazel O'Leary. And they were just so proud, the two of them. And I was sitting in the sidelines being very proud with them to bring word of this major success to the world. and that it had been kept secret. I mean, honestly, who can remember, sorry, Tom, that we could keep a secret in those days.
There's still some secrets, Laura. And we're working on that, though.
And thank God we did, because Lord knows what would have happened if someone had gotten there before that famous night on the black ice.
That's right.
And I still remember, this is a technology timestamp, I remember taping it. Remember videotapes? I remember taping that press conference for my family because it was right before Thanksgiving. And I was going home to see my family, and I was going to be, you'd say, this is why I'm in Washington, Mom and Dad. This is what I came to do. And to be even just a fly on the wall, which is really all I was at that time, it was just so exciting. And even then, you could see how important it was. And I remember Secretary Perry, I mean, Andrew, you mentioned it earlier, at the press conference, he called this defense by other means. In a big way. I mean, this was not what we even thought of. And added, we'd put this bomb-grade nuclear material forever out of the reach of potential black marketeers, terrorists, or a new nuclear regime. And I just want to remind us, you know, 25 bombs worth, you know, however you want to count it, 600 kilograms, 1,300 pounds, that is a lot of nuclear material. And think how different the world would be if that had gone missing somehow into the gray zones of ungoverned areas, into the black market of nuclear materials, into the hands of terrorists, into a major world capital. And when you're thinking about 25 bombs, I mean, that's not just the one bomb that goes off and then everybody figures it out. I mean, that gives a terrorist capability to say, okay, here, that were one city, I've now got 24 more. Which one do you want next? And you're gonna do what I ask. And that, the thought of that quality, that volume of material being out of control is just really something we have to take quite seriously as a measure of the success. But looking to what came after, I mean, there were so many lessons embedded in Project Sapphire. Really, and Andy hinted at the very first one that I really am so taken by is the impact of technical experts working together. The very talented team from Y-12 and Oak Ridge National Lab, they're, you know, arm in arm, shoulder to shoulder, glove box to glove box with their Kazakhstani counterparts to package this material to make it safe to transport. That paved the way for, you know, dozens and dozens and dozens of expert level interactions over the next, you know, the 20 years that followed, and hopefully the 20 years that follow from where we are now. I mean, there's so much that can get done when the technical experts get together, do their thing, make the world safer, and that's really one of, the most meaningful human level lessons of Project Sapphire. The other thing I will say, and many of you know, I've been involved in a lot of transportation of nuclear materials, it all comes down to the containers. And I remember there were some pretty hairy container issues associated with this. You mean, you couldn't ship them in the long tubes. So you had to put them in something, and then since it was going on a U.S. military aircraft, it had to meet U.S. Department of Transportation standards. And you know, no matter what's happening, the people who are in charge of designing, licensing, maintaining, and implementing container activities are the saviors of our nuclear world, because we can't do anything about moving materials if you can't move it safely and if you don't have a vessel to put it in. I think another lesson learned is, yes, you can keep a secret sometimes when you need to, and that's an okay thing. But then when you bring it out into the public, it also gives you an opportunity to teach the world what's really happened and to help gain the support. And as David said, you know, really build up the recognition of how flexible and how important this cooperative threat reduction tool was to the country and to our national security. Jeff Starr, who's been mentioned and at whose knee I learned so much in this process, will tell you that the complexity of this kind of a program requires focused interagency effort and problem solving. And as I sit at the White House now, and we do this, you know, every day, you know, around my interagency tables, you know, who's gonna do this? Who's gonna solve that problem? Who's gonna take this legal issue off the table? Who's gonna manage that funding problem? Who's gonna reach out to make that diplomatic connect? Who's got the technical realm, the technical wherewithal to make that piece go? And the, I mean, you mentioned it, Tom, but the Sirius CW piece is, you know, in many ways, the child of Sapphire in the sense of proving that interagency can work together, that the U.S. government has the tools and the ingenuity, and thanks to Senator Nunn and Senator Lugar, we have the resources and the legal basis to do this kind of stuff. But it takes a process, and it takes an interagency interaction, and that's It couldn't have happened, Sapphire couldn't have happened if we hadn't had that. It's been a proof of concept, frankly, for dozens of subsequent shipments. I mean, 5 tons of weapons usable material has been returned to the US or Russia for disposition, and in many cases for reuse as nuclear, for peaceful uses. And in fact, the Project Sapphire material was burned in power plants in the West for nuclear energy. And I can think of no better use of weapons usable material than to power, you know, heat and light and electricity for economic development and saving lives. But this was just the beginning, and we didn't know until about 10 years later how much this removal for disposal was going to be a key theme of U.S. nuclear security activities. But it truly has, and really the Sapphire was the granddaddy of it all. The only country that's going to surpass that anytime soon is Japan. And the pledge that they made at the Nuclear Security Summit in March to remove 0.5 ton of nuclear materials back to the United States for disposal. So I'm sorry, Kairat, your record may be surpassed, but I can't think of a better record to break, frankly, than this one. We talked about movies. This did inspire a movie. There was a book called One Point Safe that some people may recall, and that got turned into a movie called Peacemaker. Obviously, there was no one playing Andy or no one playing me in that movie, but it was an okay movie.
needs to be done again, right?
Yeah, exactly.
This time with a more handsome lead and maybe, you know.
Well, I don't know. George, we had George Clooney and Nicole Kidman. I'm not sure.
Clooney and Kidman,
more.
How can we top that?
But they weren't playing us. Is the
oh,
thing.
That's the problem.
But, you know, these popular culture components do make up part of our national narrative about what it means to be safe, what a good story, what makes a good story, and how do the good guys win? And so, you know, this was certainly a case where the good guys won. I want to say, I mean, I joke a lot, but in some ways, this project was a very, on a personal level, the starting point for 20-plus years of working with Andy. We first met on that 94 trip of ASH to Kazakhstan, and we had a little fight over a envelope of information that turned out to be about Project Sapphire. I said, "No, Andy, I've got the clearances. I can read it." "No, you don't. I have to give this directly to the assistant secretary." I'm like, "Okay, fine." But we got over that very quickly. He took me up to the top of the mountain outside of Almaty, and We made up, and it's been a wonderful partnership, Andy, whether it's been Nunn-Lugar pieces, you know, Soviet bioscientists, Sirius CW, and now global health security and Ebola. And so from a very personal story, if you and I hadn't had a Sapphire to bring us together, Andy, I think the world would be a much worse place, given what we've been able to do. And on a national level, I just really want to emphasize, and you know, Ambassador Umarov mentioned it. I mean, this is really the launch point of an incredible, enduring partnership between the U.S. and Kazakhstan on non-proliferation issues, on nuclear security issues, and so many additional successes, like removal of the BN-350 fuel, the NTI project to blend down additional amount of HEU that was found to be in Kazakhstan, Duglin Mountain, and I am confident much more to come. And so, Ambassador Umarov, I continue to pledge my support to work with you and your country to help bring future evidence of nuclear security and non-proliferation success.
Wow, that's a phenomenal note. I want to just take this moment because we had not expected Senator Nunn to be with us. And I want to just ask if you would, Sam, I don't know if you're willing, just come step up and maybe do a comment. I could see that you were, you know, blushing modestly in the front row there, and I don't want to put you on the spot, but I just wanted to say a thank you to you.
I'll just say a couple of things. I'm the only Democrat in Washington, D.C. that will let a Republican...
Press the button right down at the bottom.
I say I'm the only Democrat in Washington, D.C. that will let a Republican speak totally for me. And Dick Lugar has my proxy anywhere he speaks on any subject he speaks on, not just this. Well, it's a fascinating evening, and of course, Kazakhstan has been absolutely superb, and you got to ask, what would the world be like now without President Nazarbayev and the decisions he made, the leadership he's offered, the country's leadership? What would the world be like now if Ukraine still had nuclear weapons and materials. This would be a different world. So we're talking about things that, as David said, I think he's absolutely right. It didn't have to happen this way. It happened because of the efforts of an awful lot of people. So I tip my hat to all those in the field. Andy, Laura, you might as well be in the field. You're right back here doing it. Laura also has had a huge role to play in the Syrian disposition of the chemical weapons, which was another big success story. So, you know, the road not taken never gets written about. David did a great job of it in The Dead Hand, but very seldom do people recognize the catastrophes that are avoided. You basically usually have a situation where you have a catastrophe and you ask, what is it we wish we had done to prevent this from happening? This is one of those occasions we visualize the possible catastrophe and we went ahead and said, let's do it now rather than waiting until it happens. So we don't know all the things we've avoided, but we do know that it's taken an awful lot of wonderful people with a lot of hard work. United States people, Department of Energy, huge credit. Department of Defense, huge credit. Kazakhstan, huge credit. And other countries around the globe. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me just bring this conversation back to David to give us your take on this long view, because not only did you write the Bible on Sapphire, that chapter we all went back to and read yesterday to make sure we knew what we were talking about. We've posted it, by the way, in our posting with David's permission so that everybody else can read the text. It's a phenomenal, eloquent job. But David also has written, co-written the story of the Dughlin Mountain success, which takes place, what, almost 20 years, 15 years after Sapphire. And I don't know if you want to give us a little bit of that long view and some comment maybe on what Laura and Andy were saying.
You know, we are celebrating the beginning. Project Sapphire was sort of the original Kickstarter. You know, it got things going, but a lot happened after that. And I tried myself sometimes to make an inventory, and it's quite remarkable. I remember in the mid-90s stumbling around in Russia and the former Soviet Union, seeing some of these things happen and wonder, you know, would these projects ever actually materialize? But when you think about it, first of all, the spirit of cooperation in Kazakhstan, the Dughlin Mountain effort, which was only revealed last year, which was kept secret for 17 years, it was a long tripartite effort to remove plutonium from Semipalatinsk, is another great example of how this Cooperative Threat Reduction Program worked, and not just a quick, you know, C5A. This was a long, complicated, difficult process. 10 years working in those mountains of Semipalatinsk, that barren steppe of Kazakhstan, suddenly somebody found another piece of highly enriched material in a metal box buried in a tunnel. What do we do? And, you know, trying to make a quick thumbnail list, in addition to Dughlin Mountain, 70% of the buildings in the former Soviet Union that had fissile material were at least made more secure over this two decades. Not all of it was consolidated. It's still widely spread. But at least those locks have been changed, and there aren't any more of those antique padlocks. Also, Project Sapphire served as a model for removing highly enriched uranium from research reactors and other locations in many other places, not only the former Soviet bloc. We haven't mentioned it, but the International Science and Technology Center, which was created with as part of Nunn-Lugar to deal with the problem of weapon scientists and to get them directed towards civilian work, was a big success of this program. When we think that just the uranium was the danger, we should remember that there were thousands and thousands of weapon scientists who were destitute and wanted the respect of scientific work to do after the Cold War. The anthrax factory at Stepnogorsk, which Andy Weber helped unveil and destroy, is gone and no longer a threat to the world, including giant fermenters to make anthrax. So on Vozrozhdeniye Island, 11 grave sites of anthrax were remediated and discovered and removed, and they're no longer sitting there waiting for someone to dig them up. On the steppe of Russia's southern border, I went with the senators a couple of years ago to see this giant factory built near Shuchye to neutralize thousands and thousands of pounds of chemical weapons. And that project, which many of us doubted for many years would ever succeed, actually has also succeeded and helped pave the way for getting rid of the chemical weapons in Syria. That know-how was valuable. At the Mayak chemical compound in the city of Ozersk in Russia today, there is a massive fortified Fort Knox, which the United States built with Nunn-Lugar money of $309 million to store excess Russian fissile materials. And I visited it also on the trip with them. And this thing has walls 21 feet thick that supposedly even nothing could blow up, so that fissile material inside is safe. And this list goes on and on. And I just would like to say that, you know, this wasn't easy. It was never easy for a prosperous country like ours. In many ways, we did come out on top at the end of this long confrontation with the Soviet Union. There's a lot of psychology involved in going to a place and say, yes, we're going to help you. We're going to extend a hand. And I think that as we think about future crises and what we can learn from Project Sapphire and from Nunn-Lugar, we should draw some lessons about whether we have a reusable history here. And if we have another situation, a hostile environment, dangerous materials, big uncertainties, people who feel defeated or at least humiliated, we should use the history of Nunn-Lugar and this last 20-year period to be better at it, to be good at it next time.
Wow. I think I've heard some lessons from Laura, those amazing lessons from David. Andy, what are your long-term lessons? I read in an interview you gave about the Ebola threat. You said, look, one of my takeaways from the years, 18 years at the Pentagon and threat reduction, last 5 years assistant secretary, you said, look, the key here is the international response. What are we going to do? Is that a takeaway?
Well, I think about Sapphire, and I think about Syria, and the people who really led on the Syria successful chemical weapons removal and destruction cut their teeth on Nunn-Lugar. It was Laura, it was Liz Sherwood Randall, it was Ash Carter as deputy secretary. I remember going to a meeting in the spring of 2013 that Deputy Secretary of Defense Ash Carter chaired, and we were talking about potential military strikes on Syria to deal with the chemical weapons problem. And we went around the table and offered our different views, and I said, perhaps we should work with Russia and load the chemical weapons on trucks and drive them out of Syria. And the generals around the table looked at me like I had two heads. but Ash Carter, who was chairing the meeting, he wrote that down. And indeed, that's really what happened. It was loaded up by Syrians, the people who knew how to handle chemical weapons.
And containers were an issue.
And containers were an issue. And the Department of Defense Cooperative Threat Reduction Program, through DITRA, provided the containers that were delivered through the UN in Beirut to Syria for loading those, and trucks and forklifts and cranes, all those technical issues, those practical issues that you have to deal with. And the international coalition, 30 countries, UN special mission, the OPCW, the Nobel Prize winning OPCW, it was the technical arm of the UN for that operation. The United States, our partners like the United Kingdom, and I see Martin Reynolds here in the audience, contributed in kind. That Norway, Denmark with their vessels, Russian and Chinese naval vessels provided security off the port of Latakia. It was truly an international effort. And for Ebola, we now have over 35 countries that have contributed funding, experts, and we need more healthcare workers from around the world to get this biological crisis under control, and funds to UN organizations. There's a special multi-partner trust fund that has been established. Kazakhstan has contributed to the to the UN Trust Fund. It has to be an international effort because, as President Obama says, no one country can deal with these threats on its own. And indeed, the model of working together is the right one, and it works.
You mentioned the word Russia. What are the takeaways from Nunn-Lugar for U.S.-Russia? Talk about one of the greatest difficulties facing our relations today.
It's a tough patch in our relations because of the aggressive actions that the Putin regime has taken in Ukraine. I will say, in the Syria project, right up through the summer, months and months after the invasion of Crimea and the other aggressive actions across the border in eastern Ukraine, our cooperation with Russia was firewalled, and Rose Gottemuller was in frequent 2-3 times a week, sometimes daily contact with her counterpart, talking about the practical issues of removing Syria's chemical weapons. So there's 20 plus years of history of working together with Russia. The Degelin project was a trilateral project in a third country. In Kazakhstan, the Russian nuclear weapons testers and designers who had done the experiments that left the plutonium behind in these tunnels and boreholes and Kolba containers at the Semipalatinsk test site provided their knowledge, technical expertise to make that project a success. So in spite of the political difficulties that Russia is having with the rest of the world today, I think we have this legacy of practical, technical cooperation, solving global problems, and we'll get back to that.
Mm-hmm. You know, Tom, I would just add, when you think back about all the work that was done, yes, we benefited from it. The world was safer, we were safer, but you know, Russian people were safer. I remember kicking around one of these chemical weapons facilities near Penza, south of Moscow, and people in this local village had lived next to this giant storehouse of chemical weapons for years and years, and they were very eager for this program, this joint program, to come and get rid of that stuff. We did that, and I don't think that we should look at this current frictions with Russia as some kind of a commentary on the program, because this program was in the interest of both countries, and it is as much today as it was when we started it, despite the relationship. And frankly, given a lot of other things that broke down, Nunn-Lugar was resilient through a lot of rough patches, because I think many Russian scientists, government officials,
generals
realized that it was in their interest.
Well, and that's continuing. I mean, the conversations that Andy referenced between Undersecretary Gottemuller and her Russian counterpart, Deputy Foreign Minister Ryabkov, explicitly said, we are going to protect this conversation about how do we deal with the Syria problem from the bigger pieces of our upset in the relationships. We have explicitly carved out as guidance within the U.S. government that work on reducing threats across the WMD space, work in these areas, work on non-proliferation. Clearly the P5 plus one conversations are continuing. That this is an area to be preserved and protected, and as Dave says, it is being preserved and protected not just on our side, but on the Russian side, because they see it in their interest. I think there's a danger, however, in conflating this rough patch, if that's the right word to use, with a broader trend in U.S.-Russia threat reduction cooperation, where the Russians have been saying for 3 or 4 or 5 years now, we want to get out of this assistance model and move to something that's more related to how peers work together, how two senior partners, you know, interact as equals. And you know, when Americans pay, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars to, you know, buy gear and install it and then go back and inspect it and go back and look and make sure the U.S. taxpayer got their dollars worth, which, you know, they have in spades, as the Russians have too. It's, you know, that creates a relationship that the Russians have been uncomfortable with now for years. and that we developed a whole new agreement last summer, well before the Crimea situation developed and the Ukraine situation developed, that put us on a different legal posture and paid to some of the areas of cooperation where, in fact, it had been successfully concluded, and Russia said, we got it, we'll take it from here, whether it's chemical destruction or whether it's strategic arms eliminations and some activities that the Russians said, okay, we got this now. And that's, we should celebrate that moment. But suddenly, because that's happening and coming to, you know, kind of a milestone moment with the end of 2014, which had been identified by the Russians, you know, for a long time as a moment when several contracts will be coming to a close, it's being misunderstood as
the end.
A reaction to the Ukrainian situation, as the end of cooperation, and that nothing could be further from the truth. We have a lot to do with the Russians, and the Russians have a lot to do with us. And I'll be in Moscow later this week to have exactly those conversations.
Let me just ask this, because we're celebrating an enormous success, and yet maybe one of the most interesting interviews I ever had related to Nunn-Lugar was with a veteran of the White House in the 1990s who said, everybody talks about how great it is, but here are the 10 things we did completely wrong during Nunn-Lugar, starting with the whole Buy American provision that was part of the congressional process that led to incredible hassles. And let me just ask you, Andy, did we do anything wrong on Project Sapphire, or was it an unblemished, spectacular, celebrated after 20 years, bringing us all together for a reunion? Or was there anything that we could have done better?
Well, from my perspective, on the ground, serving and living in Kazakhstan, the only thing we did wrong was it took over a year from the time we knew that this massive quantity of weapons usable uranium was there to the time it was actually removed. And I would have hoped that we could have been faster and more agile. But other than that, the operation itself was flawless, and I can't think of anything we did wrong.
Can I say something about something we did right and that we need to do right in other cases? Is we did right by Kazakhstan. I mean, this was not a quid pro quo in the sense of here's dollars, you know, and here's uranium, but there was an understanding that there were mission spaces that we were going to work on together as a result of the work that had been done with Sapphire. And I was in a lot of those negotiations, and we've been naming names tonight. Kim Savitt is one who ought to be recognized as being one of the key keepers of the scorecard of, okay, you know, more or less around the same time as Sapphire, we agreed we would work on the following, you know, 12, 20, whatever it was, projects. And we did. I mean, it took some time. I mean, everybody's learning lessons, and, you know, we had some Buy American issues and some of that stuff. You know, we wanted to provide, you know, radios for the fast boats that were going to help patrol some of the Kazakhstani coastline. And, you know, guess what? American radios don't talk with Kazakhstani base stations. So we have to figure this stuff out. But ultimately we did, and I think that paved the way towards the additional work, is that Kazakhstan understood we were gonna be a good partner. We were gonna be with them for the long haul. This was not like, you know, a transactional thing. This was a relationship thing. And that wasn't just about the Nunn-Lugar, it was about the broader parts of the relationship, the economic development, the human-to-human, you know, people-to-people work that was done, you know, the cultural work, the educational work, the business work, all the stuff that populates this incredible relationship we have with Kazakhstan. And so I think that's another important lesson, is these projects are not one and done. Mm-hmm. These projects sit in a context of prior relationship, execution, and future engagement. And we need to understand how to do all of those pieces well to make the opportunity for future such sapphires.
David, you wanted to pitch in on this?
I would just add that I think as Americans, we sometimes tend to be very precise. We want to know exactly every penny. We have a government we expect to perform perfectly. But when you get involved in mitigating threats like this, it's a very rough process. You know, you ask if we had things wrong. Well, we sent 5 C5As. We got 2 of them on the ground, and thank God they got back. You know, we built the whole facility in Russia at one point to destroy in an environmentally safe way the very toxic rocket fuel. And the whole facility was built, and then we said, okay, bring in the rocket fuel. And the Russians said, no, we actually gave it to the space agency. They're using it to shoot off rockets. This kind of thing happened over and over again. We put in special portal monitors and scanners in Obninsk to look at whether they were handling the nuclear fuel properly. And then we went back one day and looked, and everything was abandoned. This happened repeatedly, but you know, we shouldn't create an expectation of perfection. Because when you go out on one of these missions to solve a problem, and certainly if we have to do it again in another hostile environment, it's going to be rough-edged. And we should realize you do this to try to mitigate the threat and to demand some kind of perfection for the GAO is a mistake.
Andy, you want to have a comment?
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. We have to weigh the risk of doing nothing against the risk of perhaps misspending or not having penny-by-penny accountability of every taxpayer's penny that goes into this effort. These efforts are cheap. This is an ounce of prevention. And I remember briefing Deputy Secretary Carter on the plan to remove serious chemical weapons. And he said, how much is this going to cost us? And I said, less than $200 million. He said, well, that's a lot cheaper than a military strike would be. I said, and he said, and where are you going to get the money? And I said, I'm going to ask the Deputy Secretary of Defense for it. And he said, oh, OK. And it worked. And it came in at, what, about $160 million?
Cheap.
Preventive defense. Let me open it up to questions. We're at this point in the program where I know we have an audience full of experts and veterans and students of these matters, and we would welcome your questions. The young man in the back, and then I'll call on you, and then others. Just we have a microphone. Just identify yourself. The young man right there, that row. Yes. Just identify yourself, and then maybe pose your question to one of the panelists, if you can.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Ethan Marin. And by the way, thank you so much for coming out to speak tonight. It's truly a privilege to hear about this bit of history, which reduced the odds of myself and everyone else, being blown up in a nuclear attack. I'm sure we all appreciate that. My question pertains to going back to 1994. The Soviet Union's recently collapsed. The state of Independent Republic of Kazakhstan is brand new. No one really knows what it's going to be like, how it'll shake out. Was there a hope that this sort of engagement through cooperative threat reduction, you mentioned some of the other spin-offs, or touched on some of the other spin-offs in other areas of security policy that were probably assisted by this. Was there a hope that this would also aid in democratization and the development of civil rights, of civil liberties in Kazakhstan? Because sadly, that hasn't really happened. For that matter, do you think it's, on the other hand, perhaps simply unwise to hope for that sort of thing, that arms reduction talks need to be narrowly confined to the sphere of nuclear security, precisely so authoritarian states won't feel threatened by this sort of engagement? I welcome the panel's thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to step up?
I'll go first. I think this is a subject that each of us will have different views about. So only speaking for myself, I think history shows us that no country exists in a vacuum, and none of the various difficult problems that are faced after a huge change like the collapse of the Soviet Union can be isolated from each other. So I think when a country opens itself up, like Kazakhstan did, and said we're going to cooperate with the West, and by the way, we're going to denuclearize and give up our nuclear weapons, and you know this is where we're going. Sure, there have been serious problems with human rights and democracy in Kazakhstan, but in my view, they don't exist in isolation from the problem of denuclearization and demilitarization and deciding that you want a country without nuclear weapons people see everything in front of them, and they don't isolate those things. They affect each other. But it's not as if they affect each other easily or magically overnight. Sometimes these kinds of changes, establishing democracy, free markets, and a country without nuclear weapons might be the work of a generation. And I think that we oftentimes get hung up on, why isn't everything happening all at once right now, please? It doesn't work that way.
Yeah, I would just say, as an American, we've been working on our democracy project for not too much over 200 years, and we've made a lot of progress, but if you look at the situation in this town these days, we still have work to do. But I had the chance to see Kazakhstan at its birth and then to visit over the next 23 years, and the progress that that country has made is phenomenal. And I salute Kazakhstan and its leadership for making so much progress in what is really not a very long time.
Yeah, I'd just like to point, well, yes, amen to that. But I think there's a risk of overconditioning some of this assistance. And we see this temptation on the Hill. You know, these countries are not perfect in all of the ways that we might wish to see them, and therefore we're going to withhold our collaboration with them to secure material or to destroy chemical weapons or to, you know, prevent bioterrorism. What a penny-wise and pound-foolish bargain that is. I mean, those are things that are worth doing in and of themselves. And in fact, if you have questions about democracy or governance or those kinds of issues, all the more reason you do not want these institutions and these governments to have access to weapons of mass destruction. So to me, it cuts, you know, either way you look at it, that's the right answer, is we need to work to reduce these threats, whatever the nature of the government is. And because that's good for us, it's good for them, it's good for the world. And these conditionality concepts that come up, you know, every 3 or 4 years, kind of in a cycle, only put our security in the back seat in a way that is not constructive for the country and for the world.
Thank you. Yes, sir, right here on the aisle.
My name is Peter Humphrey. I'm wondering if there's any unfinished business about the agreements, because I've heard rumblings from Kazakhs that some of the details haven't been fulfilled on the part of the United States too much. I wonder if you could address that. And second, if we have the opportunity to do this again in North Korea, perhaps with a much smaller window of opportunity, other than pre-positioning the proper containers in South Korea, can you mention a few other things that we need to know? Is there, in fact, a manual sitting on the shelf now telling us how to do this in perhaps a much quicker manner?
Great questions. David, you want to?
Well, I think part of the project that we're working on, the oral history project, is to try and help create that manual, to look at the lessons over time. It'll take longer, it doesn't exist yet, but I think so we've already, as a result of these discussions, started to think, for example, if you did have a crisis and you did have to go in, what lessons have we learned about dealing with Russians after the collapse that we could apply? What lessons have we learned about the question of the actual materials, the scientists, the physical nature of things? Yeah, and is there unfinished business? As far as I know, yeah, there still is unfinished business.
Can you mention some of the issues?
Well, I know from my own reporting, and I think I wrote this, that the Degelin Mountain project took 17 years, but it's still not finished. There's still is work to be done to remediate that part of Kazakhstan, and the Kazakhs are eager to have that that work done, I'm sure, when it gets to the next. So, and you know, that was not something that easily just popped up in front of us. The United States actually sealed off more than 100 of those tunnels that were used at Semipalatinsk for nuclear testing, and everybody thought, well, at least we won't have anybody going in there. And you know, it was an early effort. And then the metal scavengers and thieves began digging behind the plugs that we had put in and going in there. And they, you know, metal was showing up for sale in scavenging markets that had radioactivity in it. Where did that come from? So I think part of the question of unfinished business is we need to be sensitive to when copper starts to show up in a metals market that's radioactive. Where did that come from? detection and surveillance.
Well, just on the North Korean question, it's the one thing that I've learned from working with the Pentagon and in the Pentagon is there's always a plan. There's a shelf. There's a book on the shelf. The question is, are we refining it? Are we exercising it? And the answer is yes. And every time we exercise it, we find a flaw or 20. And so it's the planners will tell you it's not the planning. It's not the plan, it's the planning. And so what I can tell you is that the U.S. government and in cooperation with our South Korean allies take very seriously the threat reduction opportunities that we might hope for in that resolution of that region's challenges.
And the Chemical Weapons Convention works. We have 190 states parties. There are only six that haven't ratified. And I think between now and the 100th anniversary of the use of chemical weapons in World War I, April 21st, we can get many of those six to accede. I think the DPRK is going to be the last holdout. But let's have a capability ready to go to destroy, to safely destroy North Korea's chemical weapons, and maybe build it and across the border and have it ready. That was a big lesson from Syria. We invested in the winter of 2012 in what we now call the field deployable hydrolysis system to destroy Syria's chemical weapons. And it was built to fit in two shipping containers, and we didn't know where it would be used, who would use it. We ended up mounting it on a vessel and doing this in the Mediterranean Sea, but we were prepared to waste some money to have a capability ready should the opportunity present. And in December of 2012, January of 2013, nobody thought we would have an opportunity to methodically, safely, and in an environmentally sound way destroy Syria's chemical weapons. I should say nobody except maybe the Nobel Prize Committee, because in December of 2012, they awarded the OPCW with that prize. But having that capability pre-positioned, ready to go, I think is essential.
Yes, sir, here in this row, and then I'll get you in the back. Front right here, just to the left, right here, this gentleman. And then give this gentleman first, and then I'll go in the front row and then in the back.
Okay. Franklin Yao, GAO. The question is for David. You mentioned that there were some radiation portal monitors which were abandoned, and could you elaborate a little on that? Where were these radiation portal monitors? Why were they abandoned? How often did you find this phenomena? Is it still going on today? Things like that.
I don't know about today, but this was something I witnessed because I visited this particular facility south of Moscow. It was one of the very first Soviet nuclear facilities. A lot of Nunn-Lugar investment was made in equipment to keep track of what was going on there, fuel rods, video cameras, portal monitors, and everything. But over time, the United States left that equipment. We left the instructions. We left the training. But the people who were there, they did it for a while. And then Russia had an economic crisis. The ruble collapsed. Suddenly, people were not being paid. And guess what? They didn't show up at the portal monitors. And they didn't come back. And everything was vacant. So there's a human dimension to this that's often forgotten in the focus on fissile material. And that's just one example of why we need to be prepared in a lot of different ways, not just with containers, but thinking about people.
Okay, so was this like in an airport, and was this in the 1990s?
No, this was a nuclear research facility south of Moscow.
Okay. Great. Let's take one question here, and then we have the question in the back, but that's all we'll have time for. We're just in our last 5 minutes, or no. Jeff? Let me come here. We need to give the microphone to Jeff Starr, who was commander of the Tiger team here in Washington that ran Sapphire, for whom Andy was a field agent. And it's a real honor to have you here.
He was a great hire, too.
Great hire.
As I was thinking about Sapphire and listening to the comments tonight, I was thinking of about probably 150 different anecdotes that with a little more time we could talk about. Sapphire was dramatic. It was chaotic. It was a project of a great uncertainty, of risk. We didn't know how much risk there was. Very little in Sapphire went right the first time. And through repeated efforts, things got to be right. I mean, that was true in the, it took the U.S. government 3 months or so from the time that Ambassador Courtney and Andy found out about the uranium for Washington to get mobilized. And I remember the instructions I had from Ash Carter informing the Tiger team, I want this stuff out in 1 month.
And so
that was in, like January 2014 after an NSC meeting. And of course it took 11 months for this material to come out. And a lot of that had to do with all of the adaptations that had to go on inside of Washington, inside the US, adapting Nunn-Lugar funds to this purpose, and just figuring out all of the details about how to get this.
Sorry, I think we just had a gentleman faint. Thank you, folks in the audience. I think it just... Thank you, Andy. There. Thank you very much. Jeff Starr?
You okay?
Looks that way.
Anyway, to bring my comments to conclusion, I was just reflecting that if you were to turn Sapphire into a TV series, we would give Madam Secretary and Burn Notice quite a run for the money. But the victory of Sapphire to me really was at a national level in Kazakhstan and then again in the U.S. Imagine, we've talked a little bit about tonight about what the environment was in Kazakhstan from a brand new independent country that had long been dominated by Moscow as part of the Soviet Union, and suddenly it's independent, they have to make their own decisions and figure out what's on their territory, what resources they have, mobilizing those resources, etc. They're having many good conversations between the U.S. government and Kazakhstan in those very early days. Senator Lugar, Senator Nunn, Ambassador Courtney had a fascinating series of comment and discussions with President Nazarbayev about nuclear weapons, nuclear deterrence, the value and risk of keeping nuclear weapons. And I've always thought and wondered what caused the Kazakhstanis to say, let's give this relationship with the Americans a spin. Let's see what it really can do for us in Kazakhstan and for our relationship with the Americans. I can only imagine that the Kazakhstanis didn't really know how this was going to turn out when through some kind of unusual means, word was transmitted to the Americans that there was this stash of weapons-grade, highly enriched uranium. I mean, it's Andy's comment that about a third of the 630-some kilograms of weapons-grade HEU was in pure metal form. No processing was required to turn that material into nuclear weapons. And so it was very dangerous in terms of its vulnerability. But the Kazakhstanis had to make a very courageous decision to try out these Americans. Are they able to make good on their word in terms of the relationship they want to have with us? Can they do this? And this was something that resource-strapped Kazakhstan could not have done by themselves. Today they probably could, but at that time, the answer was no. And so this was a victory for Kazakhstani foresight, Kazakhstani decision making. It was a defining moment, in a sense, for Kazakhstan. We talk about some of the follow-on projects. I remember being in Almaty in June of 1995, after Sapphire was over, and we were at a reception, and a Kazakhstani official came up to Andy and to me and said, the Sapphire thing worked out, I'm paraphrasing, but the Sapphire thing worked out pretty well. we have another problem now. It's at this place called Stepnogorsk. Do you think you can help us with that? And so I guess we passed the audition with Sapphire. From the American perspective, this was a victory too, because the Americans had never thought about doing this kind of thing. And I can assure you, nothing went right the first time in our internal deliberations about what to do, how to do it, whether to do it. Should we go to the Russians for permission? I mean, there were very deep divisions on many, many questions, all of which ultimately got worked out. And so for the U.S., it was also a defining moment in putting on the agenda of making legitimate this idea of preemptive acquisition cooperative, in this case. There was no, this was not a hostile environment. It was a challenging environment sometimes, but not a hostile environment like you would face in potentially in Syria or North Korean environment. And so this was a big victory for the U.S. In terms of a defining moment. And I think that there are some lessons there to keep in mind. But in all of our discussions among a principally American audience about all the cool things that happened in Sapphire, I do want to pay tribute to our Kazakhstani colleagues for the foresight and courage they showed, they displayed, in coming to the Americans and taking this relationship out for a spin.
We're at the end of our time for questions, and so I appreciate your patience in the back. I would just encourage you at the end to come grab one of the panelists that you wanted to direct a question to. But right now, we need to. Andy, I don't know if you want to make the introduction for our concluding speaker, or do you, would you like me to? For this is our script. Okay, our host, and I will be pressed into service, and I appreciate it. So the Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary, Richard Hoagland, is going to give some concluding remarks, and I would welcome you to the podium. Please join us.
I will keep this short. Ambassador Umarov, Kairat, you've been at this from before the beginning, and you must be so proud to celebrate this anniversary. I salute you. Senator Nunn, who is here, Senator Lugar, distinguished senator from my home state of Indiana, you've played such an important role in history, and we salute you. CSIS, I want to thank you for making this important evening possible. This is one of those anniversaries that often flies under the radar, and this one might too. It won't be a headline tomorrow in the newspapers, but it will long be remembered in history because it is so important. I think I'm probably a little bit of the U.S. quiet guy of Central Asia, sort of the zealot of Central Asia in U.S. diplomacy, because I've been there since 1993, living in the region, working in the region, watching things happen, sometimes helping things happen, but more often than not, being the fly on the wall. And so I am ever more grateful this evening to be asked to give short concluding remarks to pay tribute to the relationship that has developed from the beginning over 23 years with the Republic of Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan, this new member of the Community of Nations at that time, through its decision to carry out Project Sapphire, earned respect from around the world for its commitment to strengthening global security and support for international norms, which it does to this day. Since then, Kazakhstan has been at the forefront of nuclear non-proliferation efforts and a major force in the multilateral institutions that underpin those efforts. and nuclear non-proliferation cooperation remains a seminal pillar of the U.S.-Kazakhstan strategic partnership. We deeply appreciate Kazakhstan's ongoing participation in the Nuclear Security Summit process, which is a priority for President Obama. The summits have been an important venue in helping to secure vulnerable nuclear material worldwide, and Kazakhstan's contributions in this regard have been inestimable. For example, Kazakhstan shut down the BN-350 nuclear reactor on the Caspian Sea and shipped its spent fuel to secure storage, downblended 33 kilograms of highly enriched uranium from its Institute of Nuclear Physics to low enriched uranium, and secured weapons usable nuclear material at the Semipalatinsk test site through upgraded physical protection. For the BN-350 event, which was really, truly seminal, I was there at the dedication ceremony outside Kurchatov, snow sweeping across the steppe, and I was deeply proud and deeply moved to be privileged to represent my country in partnership with Kazakhstan at that historic event. We're also proud of our growing partnership on science and technology and anticipate deepening our collaboration with Kazakhstan through the International Science and Technology Center, which Kazakhstan will host at Nazarbayev University in Astana, beginning at the beginning of 2015. The ISTC has played a pivotal role in the prevention of WMD expertise proliferation over the past two decades, and Kazakhstan's leadership in hosting the center will be critical to the continued success of that organization. Kazakhstan is also working with the United States on another priority issue. In his April 2009 Prague speech, President Obama called for the creation of a bank of low-enriched uranium under the International Atomic Energy Agency's auspices as part of a new framework for civil nuclear cooperation. The fuel bank will provide an emergency backup source of reactor fuel in the event of that in the event that the international market cannot meet a country's needs, and will thereby support the expansion of peaceful nuclear energy without increasing the risk of nuclear weapons proliferation. We support the LEU Bank in Kazakhstan, and we appreciate Kazakhstan's offer to host it. Today, Kazakhstan is a leader in the region, and we recognize that. It continues to set high goals and is taking on a larger leadership role on the global stage, step by step, week by week, year by year. The United States and Kazakhstan have an ambitious agenda together to address the challenges of the 21st century, whether it's preventing the proliferation of nuclear weapons or building an open and inclusive trade network linking Central and South Asia with China and Europe. This is a great expansion from Project Sapphire 20 years ago, but our broadening cooperation will help us all to achieve these goals. Once again, I salute our strong relationship with Kazakhstan, our strong relationship with the President of Kazakhstan, and what has been achieved in the last 20 years plus. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. Andy, a last word?
I just want to say thank you to everybody. I'll go in reverse order to Richard Hoagland for his concluding remarks, to our really insightful panelists, David Hoffman, Laura Holgate, Andy Weber, and their fearless leader, Tom Blanton. from the National Security Archive. Really fantastic discussion. I want to thank also Senator Lugar for his remarks, Senator Nunn now in absentia, and especially Ambassador Khairat Umarov from the Embassy of Kazakhstan. This has been a really unique evening, and I've learned a lot, and I think there's a lot for us to think about for the future. And thank you, everybody, for your contributions, and thank you all for coming and sharing this evening with us. Have a good evening.
Terrific.